I am excited that also in this afternoon we can study the Word of God. Now I have the right color, the right shirt, right? And this is good that we can be united, but not by only by the Word of God, but also by some special, you know, external sign, and this is good. Well, I understand that a faithful remnant is here this afternoon. There are still some few people on the way, but I have to also confess that I don't like to speak after lunch. But I hope that the topic will be so interesting that you will not fall asleep. But if you need to sleep, if your body will be stronger than your mind, so it's okay. Take a nap. But one thing is forbidden. You cannot snore. All right, so let's go into the topic. I am excited to speak about the judgment of God, about the meaning of God's judgment, that God is our judge. And I will not repeat what we learn in the morning, because we have only a few more minutes. But I would like to really stress that the theology of judgment is like theology of salvation. Theology of God's judgment tells you that God has a plan. And this plan is really to save as many as possible, because he died for salvation of everybody. Everyone may be saved, but unfortunately not everyone will be saved. But he made all these provisions, and it's important that we will know this beauty of the gospel in such a way that we can bring it to others, that they can be also saved for eternity. So as you see, my last presentation is really this gospel according, okay, it's not there, right? So let's hope it will come. It is this gospel according to God's judgment, and it is to its best. It's a really God's perfect plan of salvation. And we are talking about this not three, but seven phases of God's judgment. Not only three, like usually four, five, six, and seven is explained, but I would like to put it into the broader, and putting it into the broader perspective, that this universal judgment of God is really centered on the cross and is springing, each phase is springing from the cross. It's celebration of the meaning of the death of Jesus Christ for us, for our, on our behalf. And now, let me remind you that as for the time, we had these Old Testament judgments, which were this example or pedagogical, you know, typological judgments. Then we have, as for the time, judgment on the cross, with the meaning that is a central judgment with cosmic dimensions. So it's a central cosmic judgment. And then before lunch, we were thinking about the phase number three, which is judgment during our lifetime. And during our lifetime, we do our decisions. So this is a decisive judgment. And on our decisions depends everything, how we respond to Jesus, how we respond to the gospel. On that depends our eternal destiny. So now let's go to the phase number four. Now phase number four will be what? Will be, of course, the pre-Advent judgment. This is for the time, pre-Advent, before the second coming, is judgment, and we call this pre-Advent judgment. Well, as for the nature, what is the nature of this judgment? Let me now tell you that usually we call this judgment as investigative judgment. But in the 21st century, when you say investigative judgment, this term can be misleading and grossly misleading people. And I would like that we really understand the terms we are using are very crucial. And as time goes, also different connotations are given. And then the term, which was originally very good, can be really bringing connotations which are not intended by the term. So let me go into that term, investigative judgment. It was used, by our pioneers. Later on, also even Ellen G. White was using that term, which is fine. But let's think about this term, investigative judgment. Who needs the investigation? Who needs? People usually think investigative judgment, or so God needs to investigate. Is it right? No, not at all. God does not need to investigate. This term never intended to say that God is in need to investigate who will be and who will be not saved. I can give you a very beautiful text, which is in 2 Timothy 2:19, where you have the statement that God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with the inscription, "The Lord knows those who are His." God knows who are saved. He does not need to investigate. So never present it in such a way that now from 1844, God needs to investigate if we will be or other people will be saved or not. He already saved them. He already saved us. And if we stay with Him, we are saved. Nothing is changed on that fact. So if God does not need to investigate during the pre-advent judgment to know who will be saved and who will be lost, so who needs this investigative judgment? Do we need, as believers, investigative judgment, this term, do we need investigate? No, we don't need to investigate because we know if we are with Christ or not. If we are playing or we are sincere, we are open to Him. So also believers in Christ does not need to investigate and think, well, will I be saved or not? Why? In 1 John 5, 12-13, John is saying, "He who has the Son has," not one day, but has right now, "life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." So when you believe in Christ Jesus, you have eternal life. And not that will be now investigated if you will be saved or not. So, of course, we need to investigate or examine ourselves if we, what we are saying, is a real thing or is a play. So, yes, in the Bible we are invited to examine ourselves. A man ought to examine himself before the Lord's Supper, for example, to know if you admit that you are a sinner and that you need this grace which is there. If you think that you are self-sufficient, of course, then this symbol of sacrifice of Jesus, bread and wine, is for no use. You need to know that you are dependent on God's grace. So investigate yourself. Yes, Lord, I need you. I need you. In 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourself to see whether you are in faith. Test yourself. Is your faith is genuine or not? And you can know it. If you love yourself and you live only for yourself, your test is very clear. You are needing to grow in Christ Jesus. If you say no to God's will, it's very clearly also stated that you are outside of this faith, which is a living faith. Obedience will show you if you really follow or not, or if you are only saying some things. So we need to be genuine, we need to be consistent, and this is the key word, to be consistent in our faith. Let God be God in our life. So who really needs investigation? This term is good only for one group of people, creation, of God's creation, of created being. And what is this group? There are these heavenly beings and angels. For them, this term is all right. Not for God, not for the believers, but for angels. And you have it actually there in, when you go to Daniel 7, 9 to 10, you know that thousands upon thousands attended him, this pre-advent judgment. And 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. This is like saying, you know, infinite number was there of whom? Of the heavenly beings, of angels of God. And for them, now the court was seated and the books were opened. So they are those who need to investigate. Angels, but not God or humans. They need to be informed. Heavenly beings need this judgment. So, from our perspective as believers, what is the nature of this judgment? When we are preaching, we should not preach about investigative judgment, that you know, heaven needs to investigate. We need to bring them the message for people. And what is this? As I am stressing, terminology we are using is very important. Truths, concepts, ideas, we are conveying always through words. And the best words we are using, better for us, because in this way we are telling exactly how to understand the truth. And I think that we need also to choose the best word for when we speak about pre-advent judgment. So word we can use instead of investigative judgment? This is good, as I said, only for angels. But for us, from human perspective, what is it? I mentioned already this word this morning, and I would like to repeat it. I would like to coin the new term, and this term is, I think, very good, which actually tells you what is this judgment all about. And this term I would like to use and propose to you to use it more and more is affirmative judgment. Because what God is doing is taking our cases, bring it to the heavenly court, to the you know, angels and heavenly beings, and is affirming in front of the whole universe that we really decided for him. What we did during the phase number 3, he's taking it and bringing it public to the whole universe. Our salvation is more or less only a private matter between us and God. But now he's taking it in heavenly realms, in this heavenly court, and is revealing it to the universe that our place in heaven can be secured and secured for eternity. In other words, this judgment is not only affirming, but is demonstrating that we belong to Jesus. It's a revelation to those angels and to heavenly beings. They can know something about us, but now the facts, when Jesus is clearly showing what is going on and what was going on in our life. So it's very important. Affirmative judgment, demonstrative judgment, revelatory judgment. This is what vocabulary we can really use for it. So yes, it's pre-advent judgment, and for the nature, for the content from our perspective, is really affirmative. God demonstrates, reveals to other how is it in our life, in our relationship to him. So let me give you here a few facts about this pre-advent judgment, which is usually called investigative judgment. This judgment started in 1844 as an expansion of the cross. First must be year 31, and then you go to 1844, and you will see that then is nothing you know, questioned as for your salvation. It's only revealed to others that you are saved in Christ Jesus. It's not investigating if you are or not saved, because God is only what is a fact between us and him. Now demonstrating, revealing to other being in heaven. It is affirmative or confirmatory judgment from the viewpoint of God and us as human beings. It is God's demonstration of his love for us. He openly revealed to the whole universe our relationship to him. His attitude and our attitude to sin, and how he actually saves us as sinners. So salvation of God's people is affirmed here. It's, as we saw in Daniel 7:22, it's judgment in favor, in advantage of the saints of the Most High. And of course, there is, as I said also this morning, it's also a demonstration of this anti-godly powers. It's a condemnation of the little horn who will be judged and condemned. And we can go with that nothing mysterious is going on in the pre-Advent judgment. God is demonstrating what was already decided, what was already lived in life. Decisive judgment was before the investigative or confirmatory judgment. Decisions were done, it is clearly sealed, and now it's only confirmed and revealed, demonstrated to the universe. So God is proven in this way that he is just, because sinners are transformed by God's grace, wood and spirit, and everybody can see that on the demonstrations God will show. Well, I don't know if we are always good in confirming and revealing this beautiful truth. Let me show you here a few pictures you can find in our textbooks and in our publications about what we call pre-Advent judgment, or what I call, affirmative judgment. Here is the first picture. How do you like it? Of course, here is Jesus. Here is a Seventh-day Adventist person. And here are the heavenly beings, of course, representation. Or here you can see another picture here. Who is at the center of the picture? Yes. And this Adventist is not looking even up. He's looking down, right? As we saw it before. Here another picture. At least here is a little bit better, that this Seventh Adventist is living in the shade of the cross, which is a little bit improvement. And it's so showing, yes, I died for you. But you see also where this repentant sinner is looking. Here, down, instead of looking up here, right? We need to fix our eyes on Jesus. And this is not fixing eyes on Jesus and the perfecter of our faith. Another picture here. You see, the poor girl is here. And a similar picture, and Satan in between, in behind there. What is common for all these pictures? Do you see the distance between Jesus and the saved person? It's all the time big discrepancy. Here you see, big distance, another big distance, another. It's closer, but still distance. Another one, you see. What else it is there? That our Adventism is very sad. Okay. We are Christians with the long faces. This is not that we are following Christ with joy. We have these faces from north to south all the time, according to the pictures, you see? This is not what should be and how we need to present the gospel. We need to teach the painters and those who are able to illustrate to bring this visually correct This is misconception of God's judgment, and this is very, very sad. You know, this picture are impersonal, sober faces, distance, you know, and so forth. And this is not right. And there are many other possibilities. Maybe it can be a picture of a repentant sinner on the pierced hand of Jesus Christ. You know, or you can have the picture of this beautiful judgment when a repentant sinner is in the heart of Jesus. Or you can have the picture when Jesus will embrace a repentant sinner who is really, really his and has the orientation and directions in life really on him. One of the best pictures I found in the literature, which is not always the best, but it is one of the best I found, is at least here. Jesus is not still at the center. At the center is somebody else. Jesus should be at the center of the scene. But at least here you have this beautiful hand of Jesus. Okay, you are my friend. I am with you. So this is good. And you know, this is correct that we are judged according to the character of God, which is expressed in the law of God. You know, it's missing something still. And of course, the sinner is again looking down. This is not representing a reality of the pre-advent judgment. And this is not what we have. Of course, this is all virtual, because we are actually not physically present in the pre-advent judgment. You understand that? We are not physically there. So this is all virtual. And in our life, we cannot look this way. We always need to look up and look to Jesus Christ. As I told you, the Day of Atonement was all about the activities of the high priest. This is the central point. And of course, the result of this activity is that the sinner is subjectively, he already rejoiced in salvation, but now objectively is revealed to everyone that he belongs to Jesus Christ. So this picture I like very much, where you have some kind of smile of Jesus embracing, you know, and showing, yes, you are mine. And he's testifying that his blood, his grace is sufficient to save this repentant sinner. Amen? And you have this God's hand, and we are all in God's powerful hand. So we need to focus, when we speak about the pre-advent judgment, on the activities of the high priest, on the activities of Jesus Christ. He is for us. He's doing everything in heaven in order to save us, that we will be not lost. He's doing more for our salvation than we are doing for ourselves. And we need to accept it as a gift. All is really, in the Day of Atonement, about the activities of high priest and about what he is doing for us. Jesus Christ is not displaying in heaven our sins. Let me stress it once again. During the pre-advent judgment, Jesus Christ is not displaying in heaven our sins, in the sense that he is like reopening them at the pre-advent judgment in order to determine who will be and who will be not saved or forgiven. This decision was already clearly made. We made clear distinction or decisions for or against God. But what he's doing, he's opening and presenting our cases, not one event or another, but our case, our life, our maturity of life, our attitudes, our orientation, who we are. He's presenting who we are in our character, on what we are really investigated, you know, oriented. And you can investigate yourself how you are in your relationship with God when you look to what you are doing when you think that nobody is watching you. When you are private, you are alone, nobody is with you. What you are now doing, what you are thinking, what you are looking to the screen, this is what is your attraction. With what you spend more of the time, is it with the computer, with the games, with novels, or is it with Jesus Christ, with working with others? This is all indicators which tells you where is your thinking, about what you are, you know, engaging your imagination. When you are in the bed and you are going to bed, what are you thinking about? This is revealing to you what is at the bottom of your heart, what you are longing for. And here, when Jesus wants to help us in our transformation of our character. So Jesus is not presenting, sins to the universe. He is presenting our life, our case, and showing what is going on in our life, what is, our whole attitude. So if I would say it, personally, imagine that if my case will be open in heaven, that Jesus Christ with one hand will embrace me and with another hand he will show my life. And he will be very open. Of course, will be plenty of mistakes shown in my life, but also he will show that in spite of my mistakes and my sins, I always, where I fall down, I was going to him. And he was lifting me up. And this is why I could go forward. I have the courage and strength to face tomorrow. And Jesus, as my true witness, demonstrate to the whole universe what is my attitude toward him, what is my directions in life, and that my directions are for life, for salvation, for service of others, and not for sin. Even though I fall in sin, he is the one who is helping me going out and continue my journey with him. So he's showing how his grace is powerful in my life. That his grace is a new strength and such a transforming power that it's fitting me into heaven. So my orientation for Jesus and life is revealed. My attitudes and directions of life are demonstrated. My priorities, and in this sense, I strongly believe that at the end, Jesus Christ will say what he's telling me in my life right now when he's forgiving my sins. And you see, my grace is sufficient for you. Amen? And this is what is all going on. And I would say it also like personally, I imagine in my holy imagination that in that moment when Jesus Christ will say, my grace is sufficient for the repentant sinner Moskala, that all these heavenly beings will jump from their seats and they will applaud. Of course, they will not applaud me, but will applaud this amazing, transforming grace of God. Amen? This is what we have there in that biblical teaching. So, God's grace need to be demonstrated. And in this way, they will respond. Yes, we want that this person, Moskala, will live with us and will live with us for all eternity. And if he would be not with us here, so it will be an empty spot. You see how important we become because of Jesus also for the heavenly family. And in this way, Jesus is legally securing in front of the whole universe my place in heaven for all eternity. Amen? And in this sense, I understand this verse, John 14, 1-3. And I think that we all know this verse when Jesus said, well, do not let your heart be troubled, trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. So what is this text is telling us? That in one sense, Jesus says, well, in my Father's house are many rooms. So rooms are already there. And then he's saying, but wait a moment, you know, I am going there to prepare a place for you. Well, it takes a long time for Jesus to prepare a place for us, right? If it would be only a physical place, this would be something very strange. In how many days God could create the heavens and earth? In 6 days, right? And now he needs 2,000 years in order to create a place for you and for me? He can say the word and it will be like that. This text is not speaking about physical place only. It speaks about our position in heaven, that we will be admitted in heaven, that we can have our spending our eternity in heaven. He's preparing everything, the whole scenario, that we can be in heaven, our place in heaven can be secured, and we can enjoy with the heavenly family this place like heaven for all eternity. And this is what we have here. Let me also read very beautiful statement from Ellen G. White, showing how important it is in this phase of the pre-advent judgment to have the friendship with Jesus. Make friendship with Christ today. Put your case in the hands of the great advocate. He will plead your case before the Father. Though you have transgressed the law and must plead guilty before God, Christ will present his precious blood on your behalf. And through faith and obedience and vital union with Christ, you may stand acquitted before the judge of all the earth. And he will be your friend when the final trump shall sound and the sins of earth shall be no more. What a powerful statement. Jesus Christ is our friend. He is for us and never, never against us. So, you see that our imagery is very clear. We are now in Christ Jesus. Jesus Christ not only died for us, but we now accepted his death, so we are in him. And then this God's grace is changing us. Heavenly Father is looking upon us as we never sinned. And by faith, we are already in heaven. Now in heaven, Jesus Christ is preparing a place for us, securing our place in front of whole universe, demonstrating, revealing to them what is our attitude toward him. He's affirming as our witness that we belong to him, that the grace of God is sufficient in our life. Universe accepting this testimony of Jesus. And what is next? When this is now secured, we are only by faith in Jesus, but now we secured our place in heaven. What will be the next phase? The next phase is that he will come down to take us physically up. Because now we are his, but only by faith. But in phase number 5, in the judgment, of the second coming of Jesus, he is coming down in order to take us up. And this is what I call the judgment during the second coming of Christ, as for the content, for the meaning, for the nature of this judgment, I call this judgment as a realization judgment. All our hope is now realized, is physical. Now we don't see anymore Jesus only by faith, but we can see him face to face. And this is what we have in that, phase number 5, which is here. So this is now the judgment during the second coming of Christ, and this is realization judgment. All what we were thinking about, what we were imagining, what we were believing, what we were hoping for, what we are about preaching, now it is a reality. Jesus Christ is with his people and for his people. And I don't need to preach now about the second coming of Christ, because we are all the Seventh-day Adventists. This is our hope. So I will skip this part, because also our time is very, very high. So it's good to suddenly see that second coming of Christ brings all what we have in Christ Jesus, what he accomplished on the cross. Now it's realized. It's a part of our physical life, not only spiritual life. So we have plenty of biblical texts, of course, about this judgment of redemption, which is built on the victorious death of Jesus and his resurrection, and he will come and take us home. What is the next judgment? Next judgment is judgment during millennium. And what is the nature of this judgment? Now, it is not for the sake of the universe. Universe know everything because of the pre-advent judgment. Now, who needs this judgment during millennium? Who needs that? All redeemed, all those who will be taken from this earth into heaven. And why we need that? Well, because we will have millions of questions. I don't know how many questions you have in your life, but I have many questions. I cannot find the answer. And I am looking forward to the time when I will be in heaven and have the answers to so many questions. More you know that you don't know. And more is revealed, additional windows are open, and you think, well, I would like to know this, and you open another window, and this is immense. And imagine that during millennium, Jesus Christ himself will be our teacher and will reveal what is going on and what's going on in the universe, what was going on planet Earth, and in the life of many people. So I call this judgment as attestation judgment. Okay, this is this slide here. Attestation judgment. God is like confirming again, but this time it's not confirmation for the whole universe, it's confirmation for us. It's attesting that what was going on really according to the truth and his love and his mercy and his justice. And again, you have biblical texts you can read in the article, this text like Matthew 19:28 or 1 Corinthians 6:22-23, or in Revelation 20, of course, when you have this judgment of God, only with few texts alluded to. There are not many details given to us, but something we can see from the biblical text. So let me say it in this way. God wants us to be happy in heaven and happy throughout eternity. Amen? He wants that we are always happy, even in the year 1,345,044,001, that we always are happy. It means that all our questions we have need to be answered. So he wants that we are happy in eternity, even though our beloved ones, maybe, or close relative, or our friends, would be not there in heaven with us. And this is a very, you know, difficult issue for to swallow. Let me give you a hypothetical example, and only hypothetical. My father was the one who brought me to Christ. When I was born, they converted from Catholicism to Adventism, and I have my best picture about my father. Even he died when he was 90, like 10 years ago. The last week when he was facing death, in that week he was having the group of people at home, and he was testifying about the goodness of God till last breath. And let's say hypothetically that I will be in heaven and my Father will be not there. So of course it will be plenty of questions in my mind. I will not question at all the goodness of God, because if I am in heaven, God must be very good. Okay? I will not question God's justice, but I will have questions. How is it that it is like that? And God wants to reveal to us that we are not puzzled, that we have the good answers to all our questions. So I imagine that it would be like that, that God will take me for a walk. And we tell you, you know, you see, I know you are troubled about the situation of your father. Here are the facts. And maybe he will tell me, you know, this is what you know knew about your father, but this is another side you never knew. And this is why he is not there. It's only hypothetical, but you understand that there are questions and could be questions that we need to know. Or another possibility is that God wants us to be happy in heaven and happy throughout eternity, even if we should meet there our enemies. I don't know how is it with you, but many people have different enemies. You know, they are saying this or that against you, or they are jealous on you, and many things. Imagine, just imagine, again, it's hypothetical, I don't believe it will happen, but just imagine that, well, if it would happen, imagine that Nero would be in heaven, or Hitler, or Stalin, or, Osama bin Laden. This is what we cannot even comprehend, that something like this would happen. But let's say, because God knows everything, he will be there. What million of questions it's arising. You see the issue which is there. Also, I believe that the time for 1,000 years in heaven during millennium is there for reconciliation, for healing of emotional wounds we receive during this time here, and for restoration of broken relations and growth. In order to illustrate it to you, let me go quickly to example from 2 Kings 21, when you can read about the king Manasseh. Who was Manasseh? He was the symbol of evil, the worst of the worst. It's if in the, Ahab was in the north, like a symbol of evil, so Manasseh was symbol of evil in Jerusalem. Do you know what he was doing? Well, he was reigning for 55 years, the longest. And rabbis always ask the question, how is it that this worst king of Israel, in Judah, was living for long and was in the longest period of time on the throne? And what he was doing? Well, he was practicing idolatry. He was introducing it into the temple. He offered his sons to foreign gods, sacrificing his sons to gods. Could you imagine this distorted mind? What does it mean to give sons, children, and kill them in order to appease angry God? This is terribly distorted mind. He was practicing also magic and spiritism, consulting with evil spirits. Terrible things. He was the one who also killed Isaiah. We have some good evidences for it from the book of Ascension of Isaiah. So he was really not only killing Isaiah, but many others, the other people and also prophets, in such a way that the scripture is telling that Jerusalem was filled with the blood of people whom he killed. Well, but if you go not to 2 Kings 21, but to 2 Chronicles 33, you read that he repented. Do you know this story? Babylonians were coming or Assyrians in his case, Assyrians were coming and putting him into shackles, into the captivity. And when he was taken into captivity and in the nostrils, he had also the hook. And when they were leading him like a dog, you know, to the captivity, there he was crying to God, "Lord, please be merciful to me." And I will not go into details, but he repented. And God accepted this repentance because it was a sincere repentance. And then he returned, a miracle happened. From the captivity, he could return back to Jerusalem. And he, because it was sincere repentance, he started reformation, but then he died. All right, so because Manasseh repented, he will be in heaven. But who will be also in heaven? Isaiah, whom he killed where he was the worst of the worst. So when Isaiah was dying, what did he know about Manasseh? That he is the symbol of evil. That he is doing everything upside down, doing wrong things. So imagine a situation in heaven when now Isaiah and Manasseh will meet together. Do you think that they will pass each other like nothing happened? No. This will be not heaven. I believe that they had no time in this life to embrace each other, but I am sure that in heaven, when they will meet, they will embrace each other. And I think that will be time for Manasseh to say something. And when he will start to say, "You know, Isaiah, I am so sorry," he will not even finish that sentence, because what Isaiah will tell him, "Manasseh, you know, you don't need to say anything. When I was dying, when you were putting me and was cutting with saw in half, I was praying for you. And I am so happy that you are in heaven, that you repented, and we can be together as brothers." This is that reconciliation I am talking about. When people had no time to say these things on this planet Earth because of death or different circumstances, they will have this chance to say this to each other while during millennium. And you can speak about many other examples. What about David and Uriah? What about Apostle Paul and the death of Stephen? He was the one who was crowning a witness to kill him. And now Stephen and Paul will be together in heaven. There is time for them to say something to each other. And this is how they can really also grow together. And I think that this is this time for millennium, not only to be knowing more about God's plan, how he was doing things and deciding that some people will be not in heaven, but it's also time to grow together and be in our relationship with God in bigger unity. Well, this leads us to the last phase of God's judgment, and this is the judgment which will be at the end of millennium. As for the time, this is the last judgment or the final judgment. And as for the content, what is the content of it? We have a special word for it. This is an executive judgment. Execution will be there. This is the only judgment in heaven which has 100% of condemnation. It's completely, as we spoke about that this morning. And again, we have beautiful texts in the Bible, in the Gospels, and in the Book of Revelation, and in epistles about the second coming of Jesus, and then about the last judgment. So I will not speak more about that. But let me stress that this judgment is here in order that all intelligent beings in the whole universe can serve God and serve God faithfully out of love and gratitude, because they know all the secrets which God reveals to them, they know his goodness, kindness, and justice. And in this way, in this last judgment, salvation, life, and eternity will be secured, that never again the evil per se will rise again. In Great Controversy, there is a beautiful picture on the page 666. This is a good number you can remember very well. In the Great Controversy on the page 666 is described this last judgment. And it is described that in this last judgment, God will be uplifted. His throne will be uplifted. God will be sitting on the throne. And what will be above the above the throne of God? Ellen G. White is telling us, above the throne of God appears the cross of Jesus. You see, again, the effect of the cross. Everything is now explained in the light of the cross. And in the light of the cross, the whole great controversy between God and Satan, light and darkness, truth and deception is shown. This will be the best multimedia presentation. And I am looking forward to this, video. I think it will be not only one video, and I don't know how long it will be. Maybe for several months, or maybe even more, we will see how everything started, like everything was perfect in the very beginning, and then rebellion in heaven, and how it is unfolded to the planet Earth, and what was happening there, and then to the final victory of God. But in that light, also every individual will see his or her story. So it will be multidimensional with different purposes. And every individual will also see what God was always doing for him. And the result will be very clear and very powerful, because not only redeemed people, but also good angels and the heavenly angels, but wicked people, evil angels, and Satan himself will bow down before God and will cry, great and marvelous are your deeds, as Revelation 15 are saying, Lord God Almighty, just and true are your ways, your judgments, King of the ages, for you alone are holy, your righteous acts have been revealed. It means that then will be fulfilled Philippians 2, that every knee will bow down before God. And those creatures in heaven, on earth, or below, everybody will go and worship God. But when even Satan will now worship God and attest his goodness, his justice, in one moment when he will see and under the circumstances and evidences, he's acknowledging God's goodness and righteousness, he will in that one moment jump up and will start, according to Revelation 20, this last rebellion against him. After a crystal clear demonstration of God's love and evidences of it, Satan admits that God is just. His, Satan's, claims are refuted, but he's angry at himself that he testified to God's justice as he leads his followers to a final rebellion. And because it was demonstrated to the whole universe what God has unselfishly done for sinners, and that even the best information could not change the heart of the wicked, this is why they are condemned and outside of the New Jerusalem, the fire from heaven will fall down and destroy, annihilate evil and everyone who associate with it. Well, God has no pleasure in destroying the wicked. This is clearly attested in Ezekiel 18:32 and also Isaiah 28:21. This text is very powerful, says that the Lord will rise up to do his work. What kind of work? Strange work, because he is not to destroy, he is to give life. It will be a strange work. It will be a task he needs to perform, an alien task. But it is needed to be done. He's like a surgeon who needs to cut the cancer of sin out of the universe. This is why this judgment at the end need to be done. It's a judgment of annihilation, judgment of condemnation. And at the end, God's love and God's justice triumph, because it is very clearly demonstrated. As Nahum is saying, the trouble will not come for the second time. It will be no more there. So the God's total victory will be here plainly shown, and it is the victory of God's, I repeat, of love, justice, and truth. This is a victory of God's power, but it's not a physical power, it's a moral power which wins. He is the only warrant of freedom, warrant of harmony, peace, and order. And then there will be no more death, there will be no more sickness, and there will be no more wickedness. So three institutions, there will be no more in heaven what we have on earth. Which three institutions will be no more there? No more hospitals, no more prisons, and no more cemeteries. Praise the Lord for it. Nothing like that will be in heaven. No more sin, no more sinners, no more evil angels, no more Satan. But on the contrary, will be there what? Love and peace and joy and security, creative work, meaningful, lasting relations, harmony, traveling in the vast universe to other planets. And we cannot even imagine what does it mean. You know, how many galaxies we have now in the universe? Well, nobody knows exactly, but every time when I am hearing news, they are adding more and more, like 100 millions, 150 millions of galaxies. You cannot even imagine that. I cannot imagine. This is beyond our imagination. But what is the most beautiful? That we will be there with God, and God will be with his people. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautiful, dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with man, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. What a beautiful. Imagine eternity with God, eternity with his angels, eternity with heavenly beings from these different 150 billion galaxies around, eternity with all redeemed from all generations. With whom you would like to talk first when you will be in heaven? From the scriptures, personages from the scriptures. Well, with Adam, or with Moses, or with Paul. You know, this will be, we will have time to speak with all of them. There will be no limitations. The best fellowship ever. Never-ending growth in the Lord. Living with the Lord, seeing him face to face, and enjoying his presence. And this is actually the gospel according to God's judgment. You see that this is gospel full of salvation. It's a celebration of the cross. It's a celebration of the person of Jesus Christ, what he accomplished for us. And we cannot otherwise than to say, glory, hallelujah, hosanna to God. This is the gospel according to God's judgment. God bless you when you will present this gospel, that you will present it as a matter of life and death, and you will present it with joy, because this message is a message of salvation. Amen. God bless.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Moskala. Before I read some of the questions here, the children spell love as T-I-M-E, or time. And would like to thank you for spending time with these young people. That shows your love for them. Can we give him another applause? Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
This is usually a question that comes out when judgment is being discussed. Please comment on saved by grace, but judged by works.
All right. Yes, I fully agree with that, that we are saved by God's grace, but judged by works. What does it mean? If we are saved by grace, our works are testifying that we let God to be God in our life. But if we are not saved by God's grace, what does it mean? We are now under condemnation because our work is condemning us and condemning us to eternal death. So we are saved by grace, but condemned by works. Okay.
Thank you very much. Is salvation by faith alone or by faith plus works, or faith plus obedience?
Well, I sometimes are teasing my audience and saying, well, how we are saved, by works or by faith, or by grace of God through faith? And the answer is very clear. It's always in our Adventist circles very clear. We are saved by the grace of God, not by works. Only by the grace of God through faith. It's not by works. It's by the grace of God. Okay. And then I am putting it a little bit differently and saying, okay, now let's be more Adventist and see what is your thinking. How are we saved? By works alone or by faith and works together? So are we saved by the faith alone, or through faith alone, if we want, by grace alone, or by grace and work together? And let me tell you that majority of Seventh-day Adventists will always vote for this option, that we are saved by grace and works together. And this, biblically speaking, is completely false. We are saved by the grace of God alone, by faith alone. But when we are saved by faith alone, the faith will never stay alone. The faith is like the root which will bring the fruit. But we are saved by grace of God, by grace alone, not grace and works. Never. And this is, I hope that all my presentation will help you to understand that it is never this combination, grace and works, or faith and works, and law and faith, and obedience and faith, and so this goes together, but this is not on the basis we are saved. We are saved only on the basis of grace, through faith. But when we have faith, and when we are saved by the grace of God, then we are paying attention to what we are doing. You know, we are, let me put it in a different way, we are not saved because of our work. It is because of the work of Jesus. But work, our work is important. For what purpose? For two purposes. Our work, our obedience, our fruit is telling us if our faith is a living faith or it's only a statement, because our faith needs to be alive, and our obedience is telling you, well, you are taking seriously what God is saying. Yes, you are following His instructions, you are following His will. So it will reveal to you if your faith is alive. The temperature of your faith is shown by your work. But then also another thing is shown by your work, and this is so important. This work is not now important for your salvation, but is important for salvation of other people. People around us, they cannot be saved when we only say something and do something else. You know, only when they see the consistency that we confess that we are the followers of Christ and we follow it in our life, this is the powerful testimony. So work is important, but not for my salvation, but for salvation of others. Let your light shine before men, Jesus said, that they will see your good deeds, good work, and they will glorify your Father who is in heaven. This is the meaning, this double meaning of works.
Thank you very much. We're happy to see you, and I hope we will see each other again. If not here, it will be in heaven.
Yes. God bless you and give you plenty of joy in following Christ. Be contagious Christians. Amen.